Why was I close to Schindler? He was for me a father, a brother, a friend, and a god. Everything together. And he made everything was possible, even to go to the devil to save us. 50 years ago today, I stood with 1,000 confused men and women as a Russian officer told us we could go home. The Second World War had finished. We had escaped death in the Holocaust because of Oskar Schindler. Our were the names on Schindler's list. This is me, Viktor Dortheimer, a Polish Jew, number 69124 on the list. This is my story. Krakow, southern Poland, on 16 September 1918. In 1933, when the Nazis came to power in Germany, many Polish people became anti-Semitic too. I left school to learn a trade, painter and decorator. I needed a skill. I wanted to go to Palestine. I was 15 years old. I didn't know then that my new skill would later save my life. Altogether, been this time 75,000 Jewish population in Krakow. And now it's 80. This is where I was born. I lived here with my parents and my two brothers. In 1940, the Nazis built the Jewish ghetto. Those who couldn't work for the Nazis were told to leave. I didn't know, as we left our small apartment, that just 2 miles away, a businessman called Oskar Schindler was starting to make money producing equipment for the German war effort. We would meet 3 years later. We came here to Zielonki, a small village near Krakow. I haven't been here in more than 50 years. It's changed very little. So we came here with my parents, and I was living with my parents in this house. Hello, mister. My old neighbor, Palimonka, is still here. Yeah, after 53 years, I saw my house again. My wife was from Krakow, exactly like me. We have been together here in this place. So we married in this house, according to Jewish law. But soon after our marriage, the Nazis forced all Jews outside the city to return to Krakow and live in the ghetto.
We had few friends. The only subject was how to get a little bit bread, how to survive. I am not word to describe the hell. We had death sentence just waiting for execution.
And we saw every day somebody being killed. We didn't know when it was our turn. We behaved like animals just to survive. We were always in panic because every day something happened to us.
They were shooting us and there were rumors that they were going to liquidate the ghetto.
Number 13, Josefinska Street, Krakow. This was our ghetto home. In this room, we have been me, my wife, and three friends. You can see how big area we have been living in, seven people. Of course, without water inside, without toilet inside. And here, this was the main gate to go outside. And this ghetto was controlled with the police and German police. And we're going this way, and this is the way what the Jews, which been in ghetto, they sent to the railways to death camps. On this platform came people from ghetto 50 years ago. And from here, they sent them to death camps like Auschwitz or Belzec. I'm positive my mother was killed by gas in gas chamber. And they sent my father to Mauthausen. He was so weak. They killed him with an injection, with petrol or benzene or whatever. Some people were also sent to build a labor camp, Plaszów. The commandant of Plaszów was Amon Goethe. He also had the job of liquidating the ghetto. Those who could work went to this camp. Those who couldn't went off to die. When the ghetto were liquidated, we went to Plaszów. We had order to dig a huge grave, and on the huge lorries, the dead people shot in the ghetto. So these people we put in the grave. Whatever you see around you green, this was the camp. This spot what we're staying now, it was special place where the people were shot in groups. They shot my brother. He was shot, just shot. Yeah, but they burned him. I don't know exactly the place. I know this is the spot where they shot these people. The camp is gone, but what happened here remains forever. This memorial to those who died was built soon after the war. This was the commandant's house. Commander Goethe was a typical sadist. He was like hunter, but instead of killing animals, he killed people. He shot them from this balcony. For us, Goethe was angel of death. They got a plan to killing every one of us. So it wasn't different if he shoot today, one or in the 2 months. The death sentence we had already. They told me they're going to Emalia factory as a painter, decorator. So I went, I saw Schindler. So I knew Schindler. Before, I never heard of him. It was the first time when I met him. All the Jews working for Schindler made pots and pans for the German army and some small arms ammunition. But Schindler made his real money dealing on the black market. With the money he bribed the Germans and gave them anything they wanted. This is exactly the street how we walked from camp from Plaszów to Schindler factory, Emalia. Every day in the morning, in the evening, return. He asked his Jewish workers to stay at the factory so they didn't have to walk every day the 2 kilometers from Plaszów. This was part of Schindler's plan to save the Jews from the Nazis, so he could protect us. Behind this gate, this was our Schindler camp. And we came here, this was exactly May 43. After 2-3 weeks, I started to be friendly with Director Schindler because he was my boss. And I started to complain that he took me without my wife from Plaszów.
So he said to me, don't worry, I'm going to bring her. And in a few weeks, they brought all the wives here. We felt we were safe. In the camp, we were always afraid. With Schindler here, we were all safe. He became my friend. Sometimes in the night, he called me to drink vodka with him. He put me in charge of painting and decorating for the whole factory.
I was working 3 days and 3 nights with people, and I finished my job, but just the floor was a gray concrete. And Director Schindler came to me to ask me some advice, how is possible to make it a little bit nicer. So I have a red powder, and I mix with glue, and I will be painting the floor in red. And before the floor was dry, the people came already, the high officers, and they start to drink and dancing. So the powder went in the air. So everyone had a red nose and red shirt, and everything was red, like Indians. And when my friend told me about this story, he told me, Victor, if you going to be alive today, you're going to survive the war. I said, what happened? Everybody is red. Because the commander Ged was here. I was afraid they're going to kill me. And I came to them. Of course, I was afraid. But Schindler said to me, you have been the best pleasure for us. Because we have been like Indians everywhere. And they were laughing. So I knew that I survived. We had been at the Schindler factory for a year when we were told that the Germans were going to close our factory and send us back here to the Plaszów labor camp. The Russian army were getting closer to Krakow and the Germans wanted to finish off the Jews. But Schindler had an incredible plan to save us by taking us to another factory out of Poland completely, to a small town in what became Czechoslovakia, Brinlitz. Approximately 300 people whom Schindler made a list for them, you have been sure that we're going to this factory.
He had always said that my wife and I would be on his list, but he added many more to the final list. In August 1944, we were told that 700 men on the list would be transferred from Plaszów to Grozny-Kamp, then to Brinlitz. The 300 women would go on separate train.
This is this kind of wagon, what we went from Camp Plaszów to Grozny-Kamp.
This train today still goes to Auschwitz. We went down the same line to get to Grozny-Kamp concentration camp 50 years ago. The same line, the same way.
Just went to Grozny-Kamp to transfer, to register us, and to give us the number of concentration camp in Grozdrud, but Joseph was transferred to Brinnitz. And the women, they went the same transfer, but to Auschwitz. Schindler had arranged for Red Cross food parcels to be on the train for us. Food we hadn't seen for years. Milk, meat, we had everything. Afterwards, we were all sick because we weren't used to it, but we didn't care. After registration at Gross-Rosenkamp, we arrived at Brinnitz 2 days later. But I didn't know how long it would be before I saw my wife again. She was at Auschwitz-Birkenau camp. From here, surrounded by SS guards, we walked on foot to the Schindler factory, about 3 or 4 kilometers. When we saw Schindler, we told him of the women being sent to Auschwitz-Birkenau and begged him to try to get them released. A woman friend of Schindler, loaded with diamonds and money, was sent to bribe the Auschwitz commandant. They were the only group of Jews to get out of Auschwitz alive before the end of the war. We are in Birkenau. This is a concentration camp, what my wife, Helena, came here, 44. When the women arrived to us, they were terribly disturbed because they saw the crematorium and the chimneys. Schindler sacrificed not only his life, everything what he earned, he spent to rescue us. If the German would find out what he's doing for us, we'll be shot. He will be shot. Now, my wish to go again to his grave. To give him the honor. I cannot. Schindler knew that the Allied troops and the Russian army were advancing quickly toward our camp. Director Schindler knows, and we knew, that the war is going to end. And he was watching that nobody from guard is coming to beat us or to shoot us. We have been completely free in this factory.
Even after 50 years, some of my old Czech friends remember me from my time at Brinnitz. Then we were prisoners of the SS, but soon we knew we were to be free. With some friends, I heard the BBC on Schindler radio say the Russians were very close. On May 8, 45, Director Schindler let us all hear the Churchill speech saying the Germans have surrendered.
Signed the act of unconditional surrender of all German land, sea,
Liberation Day for us, but still we saw German army running to the west, so we've been afraid to get out. So we're waiting until 9 in our barracks.
It was decided that Mr. and Mrs. Schindler should leave Brinnitz for Switzerland before the Russians arrived, because they may be killed as collaborators. They were going to be taken by car posing as Jewish refugees, accompanied by my wife's sister and her husband.
And this in this flat, I said goodbye to Director Schindler, and I begged him something for memory to give me, and he opened a box with gold. And I start to cry, and I wanted just for him picture what he gave me. And this is this picture.
May 9th, I shall never forget our day of freedom.
Suddenly somebody said, Russian officer is here.
So we went to him, he came on the horse, and we started to welcome him, hurrah. And he said, get out, we are completely free, the German gone. After so many years, what we have been as slaves here, I didn't know who is alive from my family. I didn't know where to go. Nobody knew where to go. We lost everything. Homes and families.
Like many survivors, I went to Israel. Director Schindler adopted country. '74, a poor but honored man. He was made a righteous Gentile, and he planted a tree in his name, leaving testimony of the affection which Jews have for him. He was buried in a special Catholic grave in Jerusalem.
I came here to bring him a stone from Auschwitz. To put stone on his grave, according to Jewish law, is symbol of love. He rescued my life and my wife.
Helena and I divorced nearly 40 years ago. And she lives in Tel Aviv. Okay. I return to Israel every year to see our son and his family. Today there are just over 200 Schindler survivors, and the families of the survivors number as much as 6,000. My grandson didn't know about Schindler until he saw Steven Spielberg's film. Now he understands that the story was told for the younger generation and for generations to come. Until then, he wasn't interested in the war. Now he understands about his duty not to let it happen again. Since I married my second wife, Lydia, I have lived in London. For many years, I did not speak about Schindler. I did not think anyone was interested.
I'm after 36 years married to Victor, and the first 16, 17, maybe 20 years, I didn't know anything. He never spoke about it. Ever so impatient, and in the way he wanted to leave, he wanted to run, he wanted to go, you know, all over. He tried to leave. What he lost, maybe the few years he was in the camp, you know.
The one who was the radio...
For the last few years, I have been working with my friend Robin O'Neill to put down my story for his story and to help with the true stories of what happened to hundreds of other people, to write the truth about their life and mine.
Director Schindler, when he left us, told us not to blame every German for this, what happened to us. So I think I cannot blame German as nation what happened. It's bad German and good German.